Thank you, Thomas. It's a pleasure to be here. And I would echo Thomas's suggestion that you should have a look at this wonderful exhibit before you leave today. I spent some time going through it myself and find it fascinating. And even though the next book I'm doing is not about Africa, I'm sort of tempted to find an excuse to write something about Africa again so I can come back here and use some of their wonderful collections. The part of the continent that I'm going to be talking about today is what today is known as the Democratic Republic of Congo. It's had earlier names in earlier years. And it was a part of the continent that Europeans knew very little about hundreds of years ago, as you can tell from this early map of Africa. And when Europeans did start coming to this part of the continent, they still didn't know much, as you can tell from this sort of blank space here in the middle of the continent, which of course was not blank. It was filled with people, it was filled with a multiplicity of interesting cultures, but the maps reflected what Europeans knew. And right from the beginning, Europeans looked at Africa as a source of wealth, a source of raw materials. The first people to sail far down the west coast of Africa were the Portuguese in these sturdy little ships called caravels. They were, of course, the great seafaring nation of the 1400s and the 1500s. And it was a Portuguese explorer named Diogo Cao who came ashore for the first time at what today we call the Congo in 1482. 10 years before Columbus reached the New World. And he put up this pillar to mark the spot and to claim this territory, and he had no idea how much territory he was claiming, for the King of Portugal. Now, the reason that he came ashore there was that he was startled to find the mouth of a great river, what today we call the Congo River. This is the second largest river in the world. Only the Amazon carries more water. And it reaches the Atlantic Ocean midway down the west coast of Africa. And even today, if you are approaching that area from the air or in the sea, you can see that the sea has a different color for some miles out because the river carries so much silt in it. And this was something haunting and fascinating to the early explorers. They didn't know what to make of it, but they knew they had found something remarkable in finding where this great river reached the sea. However, for several hundred years after 1482, they had no idea what lay upriver, because once they went a few dozen miles inland, they found an enormous set of cataracts. Enough waterfalls that if you could harness it properly, it would generate enough electric power to power all of Africa today. An enormous set of cataracts that extend over more than 100 miles and made it impossible to go further up the river, and no European explorers did so for centuries. Now, during the first couple of centuries after the Portuguese landed there, in the 1480s, beginning especially around 1500, 1510, the chief wealth that Europe extracted from this part of Africa was human beings. Slave caravans were marched by African slave dealers out of the center of the continent, marched out to the sea, where they could meet up with the captains of transatlantic slave ships, and then the slaves would be taken on that terrible journey across the Atlantic. We have no way of knowing the precise numbers, but certainly millions of Africans, probably somewhere around 3 to 5 million, were taken from the area of the Congo River Basin, most of which is in today's Democratic Republic of Congo, taken across the Atlantic in those slave ships, most of them to Brazil. so that by far, virtually all the black population of Brazil has their ancestry in the Congo River Basin area. And this traffic continued, of course, until finally in the mid-19th century it was brought to a stop. At that point, the history of this region was most influenced for several decades by this man, King Leopold II of Belgium. King Leopold took the Belgian throne in 1865, as quite a young man, age of 30 or so, and he was very openly frustrated at being the king of such a small country, and famously said, petit pays, petit gens, which could be translated as small country, small-minded people. He was also quite frustrated at becoming king at a time in history when it was no longer so much fun to be a king because you had to worry about parliaments and voters and all this kind of thing which earlier kings didn't have to worry about. So he became very ambitious to acquire himself a colony. Looked and prospected in many parts of the world, but pretty quickly decided that Africa was where a colony was best had because this was the beginning of the period known as the European Scramble for Africa. Interestingly, Belgium, because it was a small country with no navy and no merchant marine, the Belgian government itself had no interest in acquiring a colony. For King Leopold, that was no problem at all. He said, I'll acquire one for myself. So he hired the explorer, Henry Morton Stanley, the man who found Livingston. And a far greater impact than that, that Stanley had on history was that from 1879 to 1884, he acted as King Leopold's man in Africa. He traveled up and down the Congo River and its tributaries, persuading local chiefs to sign papers that signed their land over to King Leopold. You know, these chiefs were not literate. They'd never seen a European before, most of them. They had no idea what they were signing. The idea of a treaty that would cede land belonging to your people to a king across thousands of miles of ocean, it was inconceivable. But with those treaties in hand, Leopold arranged for first the United States and then all the major countries of Western Europe to recognize this enormous territory, roughly the same boundaries as the Democratic Republic of Congo has today, to recognize this territory as belonging to him personally. It was the world's only privately owned colony. And it was an extremely valuable piece of real estate to have. Because if what you were after was extracting raw material from Africa, and that is what the Europeans wanted, and we'll get into those raw materials in a second, having the Congo as your colony was like having a built-in railway network, because there was the Congo River, which flowed through the whole territory, and then there were all these other rivers which flowed into it. And this meant there was an interconnected network of navigable waterways that was more than 7,000 miles long. This was like acquiring a colony that already had a railway system, because as soon as you could get your steamboats onto that network of rivers, you had a transportation system. And Leopold was very pleased about that, very proud of his new colony, was quite certain that it would be an enormous source of wealth for himself and his country. And he very quickly began displaying it to the world, having legally secured his hold on the territory. For example, Congolese were brought to an exhibit at a World's Fair in Antwerp in 1894. There were more of them who came to a World's Fair brought by the king in 1897 on the outskirts of Brussels, even had a military band composed of Congolese, all to celebrate and show the world this territory belongs to me. What was he after? Ivory. That was the first commodity that the king had on his mind. Ivory was enormously valued in Europe, North America, all of the industrialized world at this point, because for a number of reasons. It could be rather like plastics today. It could be made into a huge variety of quite durable shapes. Small statuettes, jewelry, buttons, piano keys, false teeth, all kinds of things like that. And like illegal drugs today, it had high value and low bulk. Two porters could carry an ivory tusk on their shoulders for hundreds of miles, up to the point where it could be loaded onto a steamboat. And porters were conscripted to do that, and this entire ivory gathering enterprise, just like the entire economy of this colony, was based on forced labor. It was Africans who were conscripted to gather the ivory, to do the other stuff that was necessary to extract wealth from the colony. It was forced laborers, for example, who cut the wood on shores that powered the boilers of the steamboats. This whole forced labor system was very brutal. It was enforced by means of the shikot, a whip made out of dried hippopotamus hide, which inflicted terrible injury on people who it was used on. 100 blows, which was not uncommon, could mean death. The entire forced labor system also was enforced by Leopold's private army. 19,000 officers and men, largest army in that part of Africa, black conscript soldiers under white officers. They would round up the laborers as they were needed for whatever the task. Often the laborers were in chains. And I think it's important to emphasize that even though I'm talking about one particular colony here, King Leopold's Congo, which was officially and rather misleadingly known as the Congo Free State, the forced labor system was par for the course everywhere in colonial Africa and remained so for a long time to come. That system posed very painful choices for indigenous leaders like this man, Chief Twa Mwe of the Kwango people of the lower Congo River. Was somebody like this going to let his people get conscripted as forced laborers and possibly some of them work to death, doing work for the white colonialists? Or were they going to resist? And resistance meant staging an armed uprising, which happened often, but they had no modern arms. Sometimes, if they were lucky, primitive muskets left over from slave trading days, and they were up against a very modern army that had repeating rifles, machine guns, small Krupp cannon, steamboats to move soldiers around rapidly. It was a dilemma that faced all the indigenous leaders, and I like to think that you can read some of that in this man's eyes. Now, the world knew very little of what this forced labor system was like. The fact that the whole colony was founded on forced labor, until an early visitor who went there in 1890, George Washington Williams, an African-American who was a Civil War veteran. He's wearing the uniform of the Grand Army of the Republic, the Civil War Veterans Association, a Baptist minister, a lawyer. He was actually once the lawyer for the Cape Cod Canal Company, a historian, and a journalist. And it was mainly in the latter capacity that he went there in 1890, thinking that he was going to find the colonial paradise that had been advertised by King Leopold, and he had interviewed the king in Brussels and been totally charmed by him, as everybody was who talked to the king, and instead he found a complete horror show and wrote what was really the first widely circulated expose of Leopold's forced labor system and how it worked. It was published as an open letter to the king in newspapers throughout Europe and the United States, caused a tremendous ruckus. And very sadly, however, Williams died on his way home from Africa and was never able to write the book about King Leopold's Congo, for which he'd gathered a lot of notes while he was there. So we'll never know what that book would have been like. Like other European and American visitors to the Congo, Williams traveled by steamboat when he was there. On August 1st, 1890, his steamboat coming downriver crossed paths with another steamboat going upriver, on which this man was an officer in training. And some of you will recognize him as Joseph Conrad. Conrad spent some 6 months in the Congo in 1890, hoping to become a steamship officer there. He fell ill and had to come home. And it was on the basis of that experience that some 10 years later, he published his novel, Heart of Darkness, probably the most widely read short novel in English. And even though he never refers to the territory by name, indeed, he never mentions the continent of Africa in his book by name. Nonetheless, what's in that book closely parallels what he saw in the Congo. And if you read it carefully, you will see an absolutely devastating expose of the forced labor system. He talks about porters dying in chains, laborers' bodies found by the roadside, and he captures this mad lust for wealth, this gold rush mentality that the Europeans had about gathering ivory. Conrad, as I say, was there in 1890, then came back to Europe. Over the next 3 or 4 years, the economy of the Congo changed, and the great wealth, a source of wealth, became something else. No longer ivory, which still remained lucrative. Instead, what happened was they invented the inflatable bicycle tire. And that meant that people all over the world who had rubber could get very rich very quickly. Because not only was there a bicycle craze, now that you could inflate the tires and get a softer ride, but they invented the automobile. There was a huge demand for rubber to coat telephone and telegraph wires that were spanning the world. Great demand for rubber, for belts and other industrial uses. And there was a tremendous rubber boom starting in the early 1890s. Now, rubber will grow in many places in the tropics, but to plant a plantation of rubber trees and have it grow to maturity takes about 15 years. And that meant that the people who could really make money were those who owned territory where rubber was growing wild. And nobody had more of that than King Leopold II, because the great Central African rainforest covered roughly half of his privately owned colony, the Congo. And immediately, that private army was put to work forcing people to tap rubber vines, as they're doing in this picture, to gather the wild rubber. Men were sent out into the forests with baskets and had to come back with those baskets full. Again, everything was done by forced labor. The soldiers were always there. And there was a monthly quota of rubber that men from each village had to gather. As the price of rubber rose, that quota rose. And then the rubber vines near a village would get drained dry, and men would have to walk for days into the forest to find fresh vines, or would have to climb high on vines to tap them where nobody had tapped them before. How were they forced to do this? Because it's very hard to send, you know, an individual soldier with each rubber gatherer into the forest, because the rubber vines were scattered quite widely. It was very simple. Leopold's soldiers went into village after village, took the women hostage, that's what you see in this picture, held them in chains, for days or sometimes weeks out of each month while the men of each village went into the forest to gather their monthly quota of wild rubber. Then the women would be released. And you can understand how noxious that system was. The women hostages were badly fed. Many of them died of hunger. They were often raped by the soldiers. Many of the male hostages were, in effect, worked to death. And when you have women being held hostages and all the able-bodied men out in the forest desperately trying to gather wild rubber to get them released, that means that there are very few people who can hunt, fish, cultivate and harvest crops, and do all the things through which an African community normally feeds itself, which meant that there was widespread near famine over much of the rainforest areas of this country. When you have conditions approaching famine, diseases which people otherwise would have survived take a terrible toll. In addition, the population dropped not just from those reasons, but because many people took part in rebellions against the regime, which were brutally suppressed by the army. Lots of people were killed. An unknown but a probably even greater number of people fled their villages to avoid being caught up in this forced labor system, but the only places they could go were deep in the rainforest where there was no food, no shelter, and they died. And furthermore, population drops because when you have women held hostages and men turned into forced laborers, people stop having children. From all of these causes, the best demographic estimates today are that the population of the Congo dropped from somewhere around 20 million people in 1880 to somewhere around 10 million people in 1920, cut in half. We will never know those figures with any precision, but that's what some of the estimates are. So this was a horrendous system, which, as I say, was echoed elsewhere in Africa, particularly in the German, French, and Portuguese colonies that also had wild rubber. In the Congo, however, there was something that didn't exist in those other territories, which was an independent body of eyewitnesses to all this. These were missionaries. In order to curry some favor, Leopold, who was a Catholic monarch of a very Catholic country, had allowed into his territory a number of Protestant missionaries, primarily American, British, and Swedish. This is one of them, the guy in the center of this picture, Reverend William Shepherd of Virginia. And he and a number of other missionaries went to Africa wanting, as missionaries do, to save souls, convert people to Christianity, and so forth. And instead, they found themselves in the middle of a totally unanticipated human catastrophe. They did their best to draw attention to it by writing articles in missionary journals and church magazines and so forth, but these reached a very small audience. And they had, for some years, great trouble getting their message out to the world, getting out the story of what was happening in King Leopold's Congo. That began to change because of something that happened on the docks of Antwerp, Belgium's major port, then and now, beginning in the late 1890s. This was the port to which all traffic from the Congo came, all that rubber and ivory being shipped back to Europe. And Leopold gave a monopoly on this shipping traffic to a British shipping firm, the Elder Dempster Company of Liverpool, and they needed somebody who was bilingual in English and French to take on the job of going to Antwerp every couple of weeks to check in the ships when they arrived from the Congo and supervise the loading and unloading of cargo. So they turned to a young man at the firm, he's older in this picture, but at the time he was about 25 years old, named Edmund Dean Morel. And he'd grown up partly in France, his mother was French, so he spoke French as well as English. And every few weeks, Morel would go over to Antwerp and he would tally up the cargo on his company's ships as they arrived from the Congo and then make a list of what was loaded on as they turned around and sailed back there. And he began to notice something, which was that when the ships came back to Europe, they were filled to the hatch covers with enormously valuable cargoes of rubber and ivory. And he knew how labor-intensive gathering wild rubber was. But when the ships turned around and sailed back to Africa, they carried no trading goods in exchange. Nothing was being sent to Africa to pay for all this wealth that was coming to Europe. Instead, the ships carried mainly soldiers, firearms, ammunition, military hardware. And Morel watched this from month after month, and he realized that he was seeing evidence of a forced labor system thousands of miles away, because nothing was being sent in return for the goods that were flowing to Europe. He went to the head of his shipping company and said, "Something terrible is going on here. We can't be a party to it. I don't know exactly how it works, but clearly forced labor is involved. There can be no other explanation for how this wealth keeps being produced." The head of the shipping company didn't want to lose his best client, King Leopold II, and told Morel to get lost. When that didn't work, he tried to promote him to another job in another country. That didn't work. He tried to pay Morel some money to shut up. That didn't work. Morel quit his job, and in the space of 3 or 4 years, he turned himself into the great British investigative journalist of his time. And he was filled with a kind of righteous indignation that he had been a cog in this system. By working for this shipping company, he had taken part in allowing King Leopold's forced labor regime to function. And for a period of about a dozen years, he devoted himself full-time to telling the world about how this forced labor system functioned. He was very skilled at doing so. He wrote 36 pamphlets, 3 books, hundreds of newspaper articles, published a newspaper himself. And as soon as he started publishing this stuff, he found, as all investigative journalists do, that once people know that you're the person who will publish something on a particular subject, people with stories to tell come to you. And the missionaries came to Morel. And he began working with some returned missionaries, among them, Reverend John Harris, there's a lecture. They started something called the Congo Reform Association. This is a poster advertising a lecture by Harris, who was a British Baptist missionary. Harris's wife, Alice, took some of the photographs that you just saw of the hostages in chains, the whip being used, and so forth. Over the course of about 10 years, there were more than 900 public meetings, chiefly in Britain and the United States, but elsewhere on the continent of Europe and as far away as Australia and New Zealand, protesting King Leopold's forced labor regime. I've seen photographs of this particular meeting. If any of you have been in the Royal Albert Hall, which I'm sure you have been, you know what a big building it is. It was filled to the rafters on this occasion. And actually, on this meeting took place, as you can see, on November 19th, 1909. On November 19th, 2009, the 100th anniversary of this meeting, some organizers assembled some of these same people, including the Archbishop of Canterbury and the Bishop of London and so forth, for a meeting in the Albert Hall to talk about the tremendous problem of rape of women in the Congo today. The effect that Morel and his Congo Reform Association had was tremendous. They succeeded in making Leopold a villain in the eyes of the world. Cartoons of him began appearing in newspapers throughout Europe and the United States. You can see him in the upper right-hand corner of this one with a chicot. This one of Leopold surrounded by skulls appeared in Germany. And Germany, like the other colonial powers, also had a huge amount of blood on its hands in Africa. But it was much easier for people to focus on the king of a rather small country. Here is Leopold again as the head of a snake entwining the body of Africa, of an African. Here he is counting his gold. And here he is meeting Uncle Sam and saying, I'm going to give you enough rubber to give you an elastic conscience. Leopold died in 1909, unfortunately not on the scaffold where he probably deserved to be, but peacefully in bed. And he he accumulated a fortune during the 23 years of his personal ownership of the Congo, estimated at more than $1.1 billion in today's American dollars. Some of it went on an enormous and expensive remodeling of the royal palace on the outskirts of Laeken, where the Belgian royal family, the outskirts of Brussels at Laeken, where the Belgian royal family still lives today. Some of it went to build there some of the world's largest greenhouses. You can walk for more than a kilometer without stopping through these greenhouses today, and they're still filled with a lot of plants from Central Africa. Some of the money went to enormous monuments like the well-known Arcade du Cinquantenaire in Brussels. And other people besides the king made money. This chateau was built by a man named Albert Thies, who was a businessman, a Congo railroad and shipping magnate, and among other things, was one of the people with whom Joseph Conrad had a job interview. There are still statues of Leopold all over Belgium. Some of them in recent years have been retouched in ways that reflect how people now feel about some Belgians now feel about the king. In 1909, the year that Leopold died, the last of the rebellions against the colonial regime was crushed. This photo shows the burning of some shields captured from Africans in this rebellion. The Congo continued to be an enormous source of wealth for Europe. Chiefly now, the wealth started to become mining, copper, and other minerals. There was also some textile manufacturing, other types of industry, new railroads that were built, but still, working conditions were horrible. This, for example, is some barracks for railroad workers in the 1920s. More than 3,600 railroad workers were killed in the 8-year construction project of reconstructing and expanding a railroad line that began in 1921. And always there were reminders that this whole colonial enterprise, like almost all colonial enterprises, rested on force. Belgians heading to work in the Congo were bombarded with advertisements like this one, urging them to be armed and prepared. Arms and munitions for the colonies. Belgians living there could expect to live very well. This photo was taken in 1925 of a club in the southern part of the country for employees of the big Belgian mining company there, where you could go into the club, have a nice meal, read newspapers brought from Belgium, and so forth. Meanwhile, African workers who came to work in this mine, here's a photo taken at the same time, were routinely photographed naked before they went to work, just as an assessment of this human raw material. The economy developed. This photo appeared in a magazine in the 1950s. It's labeled self-service, celebrating a new supermarket, but in fact, if you look far over on the right, you see it's actually an African who is wheeling this woman's shopping cart. In 1960, the Congo rather abruptly was granted independence by Belgium. This is the Belgian king coming to read that grant of independence, a very patronizing speech. This was the year that many African countries became independent from Europe, and the Belgians calculated, as did other European countries at that time, that even though Africa was getting its political independence, as long as they still could protect their investments there in mining and other industries, they could still make just as much money as they had before from the country. There was a moment the day before the independence ceremony where, as the king was being driven through what was then Leopoldville, is today Kinshasa, an African managed to snatch his sword out of the scabbard at his side and triumphantly brandish it. However, on the eve of independence, there were the first free elections ever held in this territory, and they resulted in a coalition government headed by Patrice Lumumba. And Lumumba was absolute anathema to the Belgians and to the United States, because he was somebody who strongly believed, and very articulately said so, that Africa should be economically as well as politically independent of Europe, and that it wouldn't do for Europeans to continue to control the vast sources of wealth. For this reason, less than 2 months after he took office in Washington, the National Security Council, with President Eisenhower's approval, okayed his assassination. The CIA sent someone to Africa to carry out this job who was not able to do so, but finally the Belgians were able to do so by working with associates of Lumumba, maneuvering him out of power, and then seeing to it that he was assassinated in January of 1961, and that leaders more to their liking were put in control. One of those leaders, Joseph Désiré Mobutu, later christened himself Mobutu Sese Seko, took full power in a military coup in 1965, encouraged very strongly by the United States, and for 32 years remained the country's dictator, and plundered it just as thoroughly as Leopold did. He had a more developed economy to plunder, and it's estimated that he and his entourage pocketed a personal fortune of something in the order of $4 billion. Mobutu was one of these many people around the world who realized that during the Cold War era, anti-communism trumped everything else. He collected more than $1 billion in U.S. military aid, was welcomed at the White House by virtually every American president, with the sole exception of Jimmy Carter, over a period of 20 or 30 years. George W. Bush, who's with him in this photo here, George H.W. Bush, called Mobutu one of our most valued friends. Mobutu was overthrown in 1997 and died a few months after that. And since then, as I'm sure you know, the country has been on and off racked by an enormously complicated civil war, which I think is basically the product of the fact that it remains profoundly rich in minerals, diamonds, gold, coltan, uranium, copper, almost anything else you can think of, and other raw materials as well, like timber. But the combination of enormous wealth in the ground and virtually no functioning government is a disastrous one. And it's meant on and off warfare as local warlords, the country's own national army, the armies of surrounding African countries, many of them with deals with multinational corporations, have schemed to get whatever share of this wealth they can. The people of the Congo get very little indeed. This photo is of a former miner dying of tuberculosis. I was there a few years ago, visited mining sites where you can see people working basically with the same technology that the California 49ers used in the gold rush more than 150 years ago, earning the equivalent of less than $2 a day. None of them are getting any of that wealth. The wealth is going to, as I say, surrounding countries, local warlords, the army of the national government. Many of these fighting forces have conscripted child soldiers into their armies, not seen quite as much as they used to be now, but they're still there. Millions of people in flight as refugees. Refugee camps everywhere you look, where people are living in very difficult, painfully difficult conditions. And there is a death toll. No one knows the exact numbers, but it's probably in the millions. Also, a side effect of this war has been the rape of huge numbers of women. That figure also is probably in the millions. I wish I could say that I foresaw a happy ending to this country that has known so much plunder from so many different sources for so long, but I don't see it coming anytime immediately soon. And I think it's not surprising that we see the misery that the country's undergoing today when the legacy that they have, that Congolese have had for hundreds of years now, is experiencing government as an organized system of plunder and little else. This is what it was under King Leopold. This was what it was when it was the Belgian Congo. This is what it was with American encouragement during the Mobutu regime. And what's needed is, of course, a government that really is controlled by the people who are living there and that will use some of that great wealth for their benefit. Now, normally when I'm talking about the Congo, I stop at this point, but I'm going to continue on a little bit longer in a different direction for this reason. We're here in a wonderful archive, and I just want to take a moment to celebrate some of the things that archives do and what a great help they are to people like me who try to write history. So, a few words about archives and the kind of things that you can find in them. And these are some of the things that were raw materials for me in King Leopold's Ghost, the book that I wrote about this period. This, for example, is a letter preserved in archives at the University of Wisconsin, where somebody years ago donated the papers of a long-dead Belgian colonial official. And here he is writing in 1906, when it was still King Leopold's Congo, to a lower-ranking official, asking him to discreetly get some information on what was going on at a forthcoming meeting of missionaries, because the colonial officials then knew that the missionaries were their enemies. So you find letters like this in archives. You find old newspapers. This one was about a scandal where Leopold had employed a Washington lobbyist who was bribing newspapers and paying people off right and left, trying to get Leopold favorable press coverage in the United States. In another archive, I found Morel's old newspaper. Morel, the great campaigner against King Leopold, this was the organ of his Congo Reform Association. And published a lot of information, which is still valuable source material for historians today. Sometimes in archives you can find very specialized publications that you won't find in your local public library. Missionary magazines, for example. The article from this one was about a time when William Shepherd, that black American missionary whose photograph I showed you, was put on trial by the Congo state. It's the only eyewitness account of this trial that I've been able to find. This is the title page of an old book that was an instruction manual for people who were taking positions in King Leopold's Congo that contains instructions, for example, on how to take hostages. So it is fascinating to be able to look at the actual manual that people referred to. One of the characters I was trying to trace down was a Belgian officer named Leon Rom, who in some ways I think was a model for the figure of Mr. Kurtz in Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness. If you've read Heart of Darkness, you remember Mr. Kurtz, the central villain of the novel, is a fiercely avaricious ivory-gathering agent in what is clearly the Congo, who's quite bloodthirsty and has a palisade of fence posts outside his house, each one topped with the severed head of an African. Well, you can find all sorts of literary scholars over the years asking what was Conrad trying to symbolize with these severed heads and so forth. I think he was reproducing reality, because Captain Rum here was observed by a British explorer who went through a post that he controlled as having a border of 22 severed heads around the flower bed in front of his house. And when I found this, I got obsessed with trying to figure out what could I find out about Captain Rum. So I found, in another archive, an old magazine published for retired officers of King Leopold's private army, and there's a picture of Captain Rum in the middle here on top of an elephant, so he was obviously a great hunter. And you know, sometimes librarians wonder whether it's worth keeping, you know, this obscure old stuff. I don't know who it was at the University of California at Berkeley more than 100 years ago who thought to subscribe to the Journal for Retired Officers of King Leopold's Private Army, but whoever he or she was, God bless them. And this photograph was used when an excerpt from my book appeared in the New Yorker. And I was probably the first person to even take this issue of the magazine out of the library in 100 years. I then got interested in this guy, Rum, and found that he had actually published a book, The Black Man of the Congo, that was sort of his very crude, very racist observations on black people in the Congo. And the fascinating thing here is that Conrad's Mr. Kurtz, if you remember your Heart of Darkness, also published something, a report on African customs for the Society for the Suppression of Savage Customs, I think it's called. So I wondered, you know, here's Rom who published a book, Mr. Kurtz in Heart of Darkness who published a book. Did Conrad have Captain Rum in mind when he wrote the book? And of course, you can never prove that a particular character in fiction is modeled on somebody. But I could try to find out if the two of them would have been likely to have met while Conrad was in the Congo. I knew Conrad's day-to-day itinerary pretty well. What was Captain Rum's? So I wrote a letter, to a museum and archive in Belgium, asking if they had any materials by Rum. And I'd forgotten, weeks went by, I didn't hear anything, I'd forgotten that I had written this letter. And I'd also forgotten that my letter had had my fax number on it. And then one day I woke up, and there in my fax machine was a note from the museum saying, "We don't have many materials by Captain Rum, but we do have his Congo diary, and here it is." And, you know, my services in the Congo from 1886 to 1908, and in this almost calligraphic handwriting. And from reading the diary, I could determine that Captain Rum and Joseph Conrad had been in the same place at the beginning of August 1890. Can I prove that they talked to each other? No, but it would have been extremely unusual if they hadn't, at a time when there were less than 500 white men in this entire vast territory. What happened during that conversation? Did it take place? We will never know, but it's still fascinating to know, and that's why I celebrate the existence of archives like this one. So I think I'm going to stop right there. And if you've got comments or questions, I'd be delighted to hear them. Yeah, as long as you want.
So, some questions?
Yes, you spared us the severed hand, which I'm glad of, but comments that Mark Twain made upon the Congo. Would you share some of
those? Yeah, the business about the severed hands, which some of you have probably heard of, is
there was a particularly nasty custom, which was this, that when King Leopold's private army operated, they were always terrified that black soldiers would revolt. And they were always frightened that these black soldiers who were conscripts, taken hundreds of miles away from their villages, would secretly save ammunition and use it in a mutiny, which happened often. And in order to try to prevent it, the white officers made a rule that for every bullet issued to every soldier, the soldier had to cut off the hand of his victim to prove that the bullet was actually used to kill somebody and not saved for use in a mutiny or used in hunting or some other unauthorized activity. And of course, often soldiers shot at people and missed or didn't shoot at all, and they would cut the hands off living people. And so there are many photographs taken by some of these missionaries that show people with missing hands. Mark Twain was one of many people, including Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, Booker T. Washington, and lots of other luminaries who were enlisted by Edmund Dean Morrell and his Congo Reform Association, principally in Britain and the United States, to go around and make speeches against the atrocities in King Leopold's Congo. And Mark Twain wrote a well-known pamphlet called King Leopold's Soliloquy on the subject.
More questions, please.
And there's a microphone coming. And I think they want you to talk into the mic because it's going to be recorded. It's going to be recorded. It's all going straight to the National Security Administration.
No, it's going to the GRI archive.
Okay.
Well, I do hope they're listening because my question is about Ambassador Feingold. I believe our new ambassador is there trying to make peace. I recently read a spread on him and his efforts in Politico, and they have make it sound very rosy and that the efforts are very benevolent. So then I was struck by your comments that I more believe what you had said, that I don't see how this is going to happen. So I would, as somebody who's not a historian, I'm a sociologist, who's looking at things today, what does one make of this spread or what the media is now saying about the current efforts, and what is one to look for any vectors that can lead to something better?
So this really raises the question of what can and should the United States do today to try to bring some peace to this part of the world. And Russ Feingold is the former senator from Wisconsin, who's a pretty good guy as senators go, in my estimation, although that can be not saying a lot, who since being voted out of the Senate, has become U.S. Special Envoy for the Great Lakes region of Africa, this part of the continent that has seen so much suffering in recent years. I confess that I have not kept up to date with exactly what he is doing there. I think the sad fact of the matter is that it has been a lot easier for countries like the United States to mess up a particular part of the world, which we did in a grand way by supporting this ruthless, plundering dictator, Mobutu, for most of his time in power. It's a lot easier to mess up a part of the world than it is, even with the best of intentions, which I'm not sure Washington always has, to try to bring peace. If I could magically pull strings in Washington and make things happen the way I would like, could I think of an immediate formula to bring peace in that part of the world? I couldn't, because I think it is outside, in large part, outside American control. I do think, though, that one of the first things I would do, and that I think you can look at as a sign of whether or not the U.S. is really serious here, is if the U.S. becomes serious about putting pressure on Rwanda. Rwanda has a very, very shrewd leader in Paul Kagame, who has magnificently manipulated American guilt over not having stopped the Rwandan genocide. He has many friends in the US government, yet I think at the same time, Kagame is more responsible than anybody else for the bloodshed that's going on in Eastern Congo right now, because he has supported a succession of militia groups run by local warlords that have indirectly been under his influence and control for many years now. If the US is serious about putting pressure for peace in that part of the world, a sign will be swift cutting off of aid to Rwanda, unless it does certain things there, and I don't see that sign. And I fear it's not going to come because Susan Rice, the National Security Advisor, has been very close to Kagame over the years, so I'm not optimistic on that score.
So that, up there.
Thank you very much for the lecture and for your powerful book. Both are really just profoundly important. I have a question about the arts as related to this in part. The slave traders, the Vili, were also those we know today to have done many of the carvings on ivory that show scenes of life in the late 19th century. So in principle, one could pick out some of the elements there that might provide a vantage point on some of the things that are happening. And one can see it in some of this in architecture, for example, what Philippe Dubuc has talked about, children, orphans living in cemeteries and creating a society there in Kinshasa, or photographs. But I'm wondering, this is a period, late 19th, early 20th century, where art is massively being exported from the Congo to fill museums in the US and Europe. And I'm wondering, in addition to that being a factor in destroying traditional religion, or intended in part with that in mind, I'm wondering if you've found in your explorations elements of evidence that come through visual culture created locally in one form or another.
Yes, I do think you can see a lot of traces of that. I am not much of an expert on this, but someone who is here in the audience, Professor Deborah Silverman from UCLA, who has written widely about this, and I would urge you to consult her writings. She has traced how African motifs appear in Belgian art in the period in a very fascinating way. And I think there are parallel things that you can find probably in other European countries at the same time. For various reasons, it seems particularly pronounced in the art that was produced in Belgium. And some of the things that weren't necessarily thought of as fine art, but decorative arrangements, the pattern, grill work here and there, and so on, they're African themes.
One more question.
Hi, I'm Congolese. First, my grandfather was in the round table. All my family, many people on my family are involved in politics. Myself, I used to work with Mobutu for 17 years. And now, until he left the country, and not everyone is like the dictator, okay, the dictator, but I think in Africa, the dictators are mad. Because African people, we didn't know, 1960, the independence come in the Congo. It was no billionaire people there, no family, my family, I come from a family who stood up on the first time because my father was among the first ambassador when the Congo took its independence. Donc I know everything about the politics in the Congo. But now I want to say something. No many Congolese, I think, how many Congolese are there? Many times Congolese don't stand up. Why? Because these war speak English. And Congolese speak French. And one thing I have to do and to say to you that when I came here, I came here because I was persecuted by the new government and most of the people we came from the Rwandan people, when they came with Kabila. Mm-hmm. I paid that very, 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 very hard. It was very hard for me. I left the country. I came here. Now I become a citizen American since December. But I just want to say something. Many Congolese cannot speak because they don't speak English. And there, when they stand up, nobody's listened to them. We are just victims. And you know, if I stand up, because every time they say, yes, the government is they are plumber, Mobutu was a dictator, but who made Mobutu? I was there, I can say a lot of things. And if you want, after that I can see you and I can talk to you, because many things is under the table, but is not good to talk about. But I'm ready to tell the truth now. Because we are very, you know, 10 million people are dying already in the Congo and still dying, but nobody's talking about. I'm agree that the King Leopold they show him today, but it's the same thing, nothing changed in the Congo. Mm-hmm. People still dying until now, until today. And you never see the Congolese stand up and talking about. And not in the media, nobody's talking about. Because the greedy, because the mine, and I'm very happy because you said that everything is come from the resources. But how they can tell us that we have a hope, but now I know that I'm here, and I heard that we don't have hope, because everybody wants what the Congolese have. And we can never be on peace. Why?
Well, thank you for your comments. I would echo and agree with the last point that everybody wants what the Congo has. I've sometimes had Congolese friends say to me, we wouldn't have had all this trouble if we weren't so rich. And I think that's true. If you look at some of the success stories in Africa, to my mind, one of the great success stories in Africa is a small country that rarely gets written about, Botswana, which is a functioning democracy, which has a relatively clean, uncorrupt government. They score very high on that Transparency International Index. It's a government that's been able to amass billions of dollars in a sovereign wealth fund for the benefit of its people. And I think one of the reasons for that is that its wealth, which is mainly diamonds, was not discovered until after colonial rule came to an end and a democratic regime was established, which took hold and began functioning. So that's a hope I do see elsewhere in Africa, and I certainly would like to see the same hope in the Congo. So thank you very much.